Okay. So first, let me, I would say, congratulate Chaim and the organizers for this amazing event. This is in my hat as the administrator. It really is wonderful, and I specifically want to welcome and thank the guests that come from abroad. It's really fulfilling what we're all about, to bring in different disciplines. And with this note, I think I'm an outlier here in the disciplines. And I'm going to talk about perceptual learning in a mouse model. And to a large extent, this is a progress report. We're not all the way through, so bear with me. And I just want to share with you the kind of things that we do and where we are at this point in time. So a few years back, we started to get interested in perceptual learning. And as many of you know, perceptual learning is an implicit type of learning. It has to do with lots of practice. It has to do with the reaching perceptual limits, often studied in sensory systems. And it is thought to be specific to the learning task that was learned by the animal. It is a very basic learning procedure generally in the animal kingdom. And if you look at this hunting lioness with its exquisite sharp senses, she had to learn to do this during her lifetime. And also things like human learning, even human learning, has foundations that have to do with the perceptual learning. So we're interested in what are the neural correlates and mechanisms therein in perceptual learning in the mammalian brain. Let's get this up to speed. And although I would love to go into the brain of the lioness, I cannot, nor the human brain, of course. So we go to the mice. And the question is, you know, why mice? And the obvious question, the obvious answer is that it allows us unprecedented cellular, genetic, and molecular specificity, not only specificity, but efficiency, access, and specificity, to sink our teeth into neurons and molecules and genes and cells and circuits of the brain that have to do with perceptual learning. And the toolkit is exciting. It's exciting to be an experimental neuroscientist these days, and we can't even keep up with the pace of powerful techniques that let us and allow us to look at different topics, in this case, perceptual learning. And to a large extent, I sympathize a lot with this quote by Sidney Brenner that says that progress in science depends on new techniques, new discoveries, and new ideas, probably in that order. So we're applying starting to apply some of the powerful techniques into looking into perceptual learning. And excuse me, I'm a little bit sick, so I'll have to use these water to help me out here. Today I'm going to talk about physiology and behavior, and I have to confess that when you go into mice, you know, we are in the forefront of science when it's about sinking our teeth into molecules and genes, but behavior can be a little wishy-washy, so we had to start with behavior for perceptual learning in mice. So let me start with the behavior. We built a behavioral apparatus for mice. We call it the EduCage. And this is an apparatus where mice live together happily with big families. Zero human interference. We only implant a chip, an RFID chip, under their skin, and they get all their water in what we call the training chamber on the right. When the mice go there to drink, the computer identifies the mice individually, brings up their own learning training paradigm, and they can train on whatever task this has been designed. And they live there, they can even be born in the cage, and learn the tasks that we play in. And when you look at perceptual learning, it has to do with very long practice and time, so this makes it very useful. We have about 5 cages now running in the lab. They're highly modular. You can connect different cages. It is built to be low cost and friendly to the community. And in my laboratory, we have experience in the edu cage in the context of olfaction and audition. So in olfaction, just to give you a flavor, we can easily teach them a go-no-go task to discriminate between a banana odor and an apple odor, and to discriminate the where the higher concentration of the odor is, basically putting a decision boundary in the middle. But that's easy. They can do it in a few trials. But we can also teach them very hard tasks, like putting 5 decision boundaries along this stimulus space. And quite remarkably, within a few weeks of training, mice can perform on this task and reverse online from one task to another. But I will not talk about the neural correlates of the olfactory edu case today. Today, we'll talk about the auditory aspect. Here? Okay, great. Today, we'll talk about the auditory aspect. We have experience with a few different tasks. The one I'll talk about today is a simple go-no-go design where we train the animal to discriminate one frequency versus another and then make it harder and harder and harder until they collapse perceptually and until they become experts at discriminating this green and red. But we also have other categorization-like tasks, like, again, like the olfactory one, putting the decision boundary in the middle and discriminating either left or right of that frequency, or more recently, FM sweeps going up or down and putting the decision boundary at the FM, and also training them for natural sounds. And I will talk today about the natural sounds and a very simple pure tone design. So let's start with the simple one. The mouse sticks his head into the water port, and he either hears a go sound, which is a 10 kilohertz tone. He can either lick and get a reward, or doesn't lick and no worries, just gets a miss. And if he hears, when it hears the lower sound, he can either reject, which is the correct thing to do, or lick and it gets a false alarm. We can either punish them or not punish them. The punishment here is a mild air puff to the face, plus a few seconds of a timeout. But again, we also have a non-punished version. So just so you get a feeling of how it looks like. So this is where they happily live in their home cage. You can't see it here. All the mice live together. They have a bridge to this training port. And this is, to some extent, Kalanitz, analog to the Kalanitz, asking the question of, what do you feel? So we can, again, I won't exhaust you too much with this goes on and on and on and on. And another mouse comes in and another one comes out, OK? Let's get one here. And we can measure the amount of licking, the licking speed, when he puts the head in, when he puts the head out, calculate detection times, and things of that sort. And again, this goes on for 24/7, for day after day after day after day. So the first thing is to teach them the procedure. And there is a lot of variation between different mice. What you see here are 3 learners, a fast learner that even within the first trial, actually even within the first 10 trial, learned the task and gets better and better at it. Again, this is the easy task, not a problem. But some mice take a much longer time to learn the task. On average, within 50 trials, all mice cross the D prime of 1, which is our criterion. And this is, in this case, again, 40 mice. Another big advantage of the edu cage, you can train many animals simultaneously. And the next thing that we do is what I learned today from a DAFNA, a curriculum type of a learning. We start very easy on a half octave difference, 7 to 10. And once they reach performance, stable performance for a day or two, the machine can automatically make it harder to decrease the distance between the go and the no-go. This becomes harder, but they're able to do it. And we make it harder and harder until at some point, all mice, of course, collapse. And the JND, the just noticeable difference range, is 3 to 8% roughly in our hands. Again, it depends on the task. It can be better or not. Just to show that this is a perceptual learning task, what we do is we bring them back to an easier task after they collapse, and we calculate, we let them work again for a few days. throw in catch trials and build psychometric curves. And what you can see, not only does the D prime improve in these mice after learning, but also their psychometric curves on the same difficulty level is improved as evident by the slope of the psychometric curves. And one experiment which I like in particular is this gradual training experiment. So you take 10 mice, for example, and you split them into two groups. One, you train them on the easy task. The other ones, you train them on the easy task, and they work together. Only on one type, on one group, you make the task harder and harder and harder. The other group continues to train simultaneously. So one is the gradual training group, and one is the non-gradual training group. This is what you saw before. And this is the non-gradual. They work simultaneously, and then we test them both on the hard task. And all the mice that are not gradually training, making it more difficult and difficult, again, like we learned from Daphna perhaps this morning, they can do the task, while all the ones that were not trained will collapse. And this just means that gradual training is important for this particular task. Okay, so now that we have set the stage for mouse perceptual learning, we want to go deeper into the physiology. Again, today I will only share with you the physiological part, and we started by asking what are the neural correlates of perceptual learning in the mouse brain. The first question is, where do you stick your electrodes in the brain? So auditory cortex is a good start, I would argue. It's a few synapses away from the cochlea. And if you open a textbook, there is vast literature about synaptic tonotopic plasticity in the auditory cortex. You see this in many animals, although it's somewhat debatable in the field, but I think the majority is that you do see changes in tonotopy. This is an example from Mike Mersnich and Dan Poli training a rat on a go-no-go task to go for 4 kilohertz. And you can see 4 kilohertz was represented earlier by a few of these squares, and if you map the cortex later, there's an expansion of tonotopy. And this is true also in cats and monkeys, and some evidence in musicians and humans as well, etc. So we decided to put our electrodes and recording apparati in the auditory cortex. I'm going to tell you about two experiments. One are loose patch recordings under two photon guidance in anesthetized mice from layer 2-3 only. And the second one is two photon calcium imaging in awake passive mice. So what we do, we record with loose patch recording to get extremely high signal-to-noise ratio, and the non-biased recording from single neurons. Recording are very often sparse in cortex, in auditory cortex. And you get a receptive field that looks like this. In this case, this neuron responds to higher frequencies. And you can see the same neuron in a different representation, which we call the frequency response area. Again, this neuron responds to this frequency. The best frequency of the neuron is around here, somewhere in the middle. So if we just plot these tuning curves of single neurons one by one, we can plot, again, this is receptive field of two or tuning curves of two different neurons in a naive animal. And we did this in many of our mice. So this is 23 mice and 112 tuning curves. You can see they cover the whole spectrum of the auditory soundscape, if you will, of the hearing range, of the mice. And if you do this in these expert mice that train for a few weeks in the educage, you can even see by eye there's a bump here that the tuning curves are more, there's more energy here within the training range, which is between 7 and 10 kilohertz. And when we quantify it, indeed, you look at the best frequency. If the training was around here, you see there is a shift in BF towards the training frequencies. When you look at the width of the tuning curves, these do not change. And this means that the tuning curves are shifting along the tonotopic axis. And this is great, okay? But if you really want to look at neurons shifting along, single neuron recordings are very difficult. And we had to turn into two photon imaging, which allows us to follow the same neurons again and again. That's one thing. The second thing is that it is now argued that it's not about only the single neurons, it's about the population or ensembles of cells and how they change as we learn. To do this, we inject what we call the a watermelon construct, a virus in the brain of mice, and this means that it will express a TD tomato or a D tomato signal in the nucleus and a calcium indicator in the cytosol of the neurons. This is how it looks like. We implant a chronic cranial window and put the mice under a two-photon microscope so we can look and take a look inside for the cells. So just so you get a feeling of how this looks like, so this is looking at the surface of the brain of a mouse, and we're just now going to change the focus down, and you can see we're going down 200 microns, 300 microns. At 400 microns, it starts to become fuzzy. Okay, so let's go down again and stop here. So this is a roughly layer 2-3. You start to see, you see these are individual neurons with their red nuclei. You can see even some dendrites, etc. And we zoom in and choose some focal plane, and we can then start to play sounds and record from the mice, in this case in awake passive mode. So you can see the mice are held under skull under the microscope here. The cranial window is on the side. You can see even the laser scanning here. And the mice are happily running on this wheel or walking or grooming or whatever, just passively listening to the different sound. And this is the raw data that comes out of the microscope. Don't know if you can hear. And this goes on and on and on for about an hour or 2 hours until we get the full receptive field, and in this case, some natural sounds that we play as well. The big advantage of two-photon microscopy is that you can follow the exact same neurons over time, in this case, over a few weeks, and say and ask whether something has changed, and if so, which one has changed. The imaging protocol is a control group where we image at day minus two, day zero, where nothing has happened. And then they do nothing, and we image them again at two time points, so naive 3 and 4, or this perceptual learning group where we image the same neurons over a few weeks. And to cut a long story short, it's a hell of a mess in the brain. So we see both volatility and stability in auditory cortex. So just to give you a feel, here are a few examples. This is a good representative example of a stable neuron, responding nicely to 20 kilohertz here on day two, 2 days later, a few weeks later, and a few weeks later. Rock solid, we can trust this neuron for the future. Here's another good representative example, a neuron in the vicinity, I must say, that is stable along the few weeks. And here is a real representative example. This is what we normally see. An asterisk means a response that is statistically significant. You see this guy responded to 4 kilohertz, sluggishly here, at day zero somewhere here, and then after training, looked like before training. So, you know, a little bit of a mess. And here's our star. This is the figure 1A neuron, what I would call the best representative example of what we would imagine from the Mersnich literature. So this neuron responded to 11 to 16 kilohertz before the training, was stable, and then after training shifted along towards the training frequency. In this case, it was this region. So this is a beauty. We don't get much of these best representative examples. Nevertheless, this is the whole data plotted. This is in naive 2 and a few weeks later, naive 3. This is the best frequency of each neuron. And a neuron that did not change throughout this, the weeks will appear on the diagonal. You can see that most, and the size of the circle is the intensity of the response, you can see that most of the cells lie roughly on the diagonal, although there is quite a bit of noise around it. In mice that were training, we see a little bit of a different phenomena. We see this blimp of activity in the training band, which is around 10 to from here to here, from 7 to 10 kilohertz. So this was the condition before the training. This is the receptive, the best frequency after training. And you can see this receptive, or the BF getting a little denser around the training frequencies. And if we plot this, one way to plot this is how far the BF is from the training frequency, and there is after the expert mice, they go closer to the training frequency. So this means that we get a similar result to what we saw with the single neuron spiking responses. Of course, with two-photon imaging, you can do more fancy thing and ask which neurons actually changed. So this is what we call a three-way signal correlation. We do a Pearson correlation between the receptive field of a neuron before learning and after an easy learning, after it just started to learn. And you can see that neurons that are highly sensitive start to fall under the diagonal. And after the perceptual learning, after hard training, most of the cells will fall under the diagonal. And in fact, if you just, you know, eyeball this graph, you see that the stable neurons actually became less stable with training. We're still analyzing this data, but just to give you a feel of how this neuron looks like, which was pretty stable in the naive condition. So this is naive one, naive two, the receptive field, and collapsed in terms of the analysis between naive two and JND, the just noticeable difference. This is another best representative example. But again, the data is rich. Neurons change into different direction. But the bottom line is that we, as others, also find an overrepresentation of the learned frequencies after perceptual learning in mice. This is a good thing. We have a strong genetic animal model to study. But being part of LSEC, one of the main questions in this building and in our community is, so what? So you have overrepresentation. So when you have this hard question of so what, or who cares that you have overrepresentation in the brain, I have many computational colleagues around me. In this case, we bonded with Chaim Sampolinsky and Ravid Ziv Schwartz, I must say, and to look at whether overrepresentation of the network is useful at all. So what Chaim did, and don't ask me on the math, is calculate the Fisher information out of the tuning curves of these cells. And the animal was training on the 7 to 10. And quite surprisingly, we found that although there is an improvement in the expert group, which is shown here in the blue, it was not within the training band, but in the flanking regions of the training band. So that was a little bit peculiar. And within the training band, if anything, there is a decrease in performance. So not only that this overrepresentation doesn't help you, it may help you outside the learning band, but it doesn't really help you within the training band. To cut a long story short, Chaim and Ravid also looked at the neurons more carefully and built models of modeled neurons and could ask how many neurons are enough to sample. Within the training band, again, no improvement. If anything, there is a decrease in improvement at large numbers of neurons. So these changing in tuning curves do not really improve discriminability at the learned frequencies, which, you know, got us thinking. So this is in every textbook. We also get it in mice. But in this case, doesn't really improve the discriminability. We're still thinking about it. This has a lot of meaning. I must say it was a great step forward that we did. It means either we're looking in the wrong place of the brain, either this is an epiphenomena or some emergent property from a brain region or a higher brain region, I don't know, but nevertheless, that's the result. That said, we took it to a little bit of a different direction and jumping from pure tones into natural sounds. This is much of because of my interaction with Ellie, my better half in LSEC, looking at the role of auditory cortex in coding sound information. And we know very well what the periphery of the auditory system is doing. When you look at pure tones, or even when you look at complex sounds, it's a nice, you know, spectrogram of the sound, breaking it to the different tones quite reliably. If we look at pure tones in auditory cortex, it's nicely organized tonotopically with some noise, but nevertheless, you know, you can roughly know which frequency you're at. But the argument of Ellie and others is that auditory cortex is not really about pure tones, it's about complex sounds. And although Ellie and his colleagues and others have shown some fundamental computations of complex sounds, the truth of the matter is that we still don't know what auditory cortex does, how it does it, etc. So we thought to jump into the water but by looking at natural sounds in the context of perceptual learning. To cut a long story short, I have a lot of arguments with Ellie about this. There are different natural sounds, which ones to choose. We like vocalizations. Why? Because we like vocalizations. They have a social meaning for mothers. We also study mothers, but we study vocalizations as the natural sound stimulus. So first of all, take your electrode, stick it into the auditory cortex, and ask, how does the auditory cortex code vocalization? And surprise, surprise, it's a jungle out there. These are 15 single unit recording from auditory cortex to this seven second natural sound of one of the pups. And you can see you get everything you want. Cell number one responds very sparsely, maybe to this syllable and this syllable at, I don't know, 20%. Cell number two responds only to this syllable, this syllable as well. Cell number seven responds to each and every syllable with a few spikes. This one only to the first one and stops. Good luck figuring out what's happening here, but nevertheless, and even worse, is while tonotopy is nicely organized, you saw this even in the human cortex, or for the vision, of course, here, when you stick an electrode to a next-door neighbor in two-photon patch, they can show completely different responses to this vocalization or other vocalization or even to the same vocalization. These are 10 neurons patched within a perimeter of 150 microns, and the correlation, the Pearson correlation between the PSTH correlation, between the responses is near zero. So each neuron does very different things when a natural sound comes in and you look at into the cortex. Anyway, to cut a long story short, we played these wriggling calls, which are pup calls, and this is the go signal. And the go signal was a modulation in FM, so it's a symmetric modulation of the sound. So we make it, so this would be the go signal, the one that we recorded from the baby pups. And this would be the no-go for a very strong modulation, a 0.4 modulation, which comes up to what we call a speeding factor of 0.6, and it's slower here and faster here, so you see this is a symmetric modulation, and we can make this closer to this in a morphing type of fashion until it's almost alike. So this is a 9% modulation of the call. This is much harder. So the animals first train to discriminate this from this, the very easy task. Once they get better, after a few days, we make it harder and harder and harder until they collapse. This you saw before, it takes these mice to learn about 50 trials on average to learn the pure tone discrimination. It takes much longer to learn the vocalizations, about 200 trials on average in this case, and the learning curves, the slopes are lower. That said, they get to very good D prime values, and they abruptly collapse at about at 9% or so of the calls. Interestingly, like I told you, we also measure detection times. So at similar D prime levels, so this is the detection time for pure tones. You can calculate detection times in different ways in mice. Here we calculate by licks, which is a little slower. So this is actually higher values than the real life values is. But nevertheless, as a comparative measure, it's good. About 500 milliseconds to do the easy task, and it gets harder. And the vocalization takes, on average, for similar D primes, about 600 milliseconds more time to make a right decision for these mice. So when we asked mice to discriminate, this is on purpose, it's fine. When we ask mice to discriminate two tones, what we see is an overrepresentation in cortex of the learned tones. So naturally, we expected that we get an overrepresentation of these calls or syllables in the auditory cortex, and surprise, surprise, we get exactly the opposite. So this is a neuron in a naive animal, this is an example neuron in an expert neuron, you already get the feel that the responses here are actually sparser. And if you look across the neurons that we recorded, the blue neurons are the experts, they're always under the red histogram, and in fact, we see a very clear sparsening of the responses as opposed to overrepresentation, which we saw in the pure tones. When we quantify it, There are different ways to quantify it. The latest one that we use is lifetime sparseness. You see that in the expert mice, a four matched intensity evoked firing rates, we get the higher sparseness of the expert and, of course, as a general. Another phenomena is that we get a decorrelation of the responses when we compare the neurons to the different modulations of the call. So these are the values in a naive animal, and they are lower in the expert animal, meaning that there is a decorrelation between the responses to the different modulations of the call. And this also passes the decoder test. So in fact, the network in the expert mice do better than the naive mice. So to summarize what I've told you so far, how am I on time? Good? Okay, so I can show off in the last 5 minutes. So what I wanted to share with you today, just to summarize, is that we developed an automated behavioral cage, which we call the EduCage. We love the name as well, to train mice on a perceptual learning task using both pure tones and vocalizations. And neural correlates of perceptual learning in A1 are complex. In terms of pure tones, we do find overrepresentation, like our colleagues have for many, many years. However, it does not seem to improve decoding. However, when we train animals for natural sounds, we see sparsening, and this does improve coding, and this suggests some role in perceptual learning in A1 for complex sounds, and also teaches us something about, you know, whether we should look elsewhere. So in the last 2-3 minutes, I just want to tell you that we are looking elsewhere. And we started to look at downstream auditory cortex, and this is where mice really come into play as a powerful tool. And please be cautious, these are preliminary data. So we used, together with Li-Chan Lu at Stanford, Li-Chan developed a very cool genetic mouse that uses genetics and immediate early genes to map in an unbiased way where in the brain we see activity. And, you know, this has many caveats, but we took, I think, 4 years to calibrate these mice. And if you look in a control mice, you do see some noisy neurons that express immediate early genes on a mouse running in the cage. But when you play sounds, of course, regions in the auditory stream light up. In this case, you can see an increase in the number of neurons in A1. But we also very consistently saw another brain region called the temporal association area, which lights up as well. This is in many ways like fMRI for the whole brain, but at single cell resolution. This is the quantification. So in auditory cortex, we get about 3-fold increase. And in temporal association cortex, we get about almost 6-fold increase in the number of cells responding to these calls. Again, together with Li-Chan Lu and in a project together with Ed Calloway from Salk, we are targeting these neurons that are highly active to the vocalizations and tracing their synaptic connectivity onto these cells. So this is an example from one of these animals. The yellow cells are what we call the seed cells or the starter cells. These are the neurons that respond to the vocalizations. And all the green cells are neurons that are synaptically connected to these highly active cells in this case, in temporal association cortex. And we find that they get robust input from A1, from layer 5 in A1, which means that TA is downstream of A1. And interestingly, we also see thalamic input. So if you look at tracing from A1, if the seeds would be in A1, you see inputs from the ventral part of the thalamus. But here we see almost exclusively inputs from the dorsal and medial regions of the thalamus, which means that this is a higher order or non-lemniscal input to this region. If you look at the literature, very little is known about temporal association area in general, almost nothing. So now, using these genetic tools, we mapped the inputs to temporal association cortex. And we were very pleased to find very interesting regions that make synapses onto this region, like the lateral amygdala, piriform cortex, orbitofrontal cortex. And you can imagine this is a ripe and rich substrate on which now to study temporal association cortex. And with the help of our friends in Gatsby after the meeting last year, and Sarah is here with us too, as you may know, the latest, hottest thing in electrophysiology is neuropixels. And part of the Gatsby consortium, we were able to use the neuropixels, which gives you the ability to record from different brain regions simultaneously and get quite a bit of units at single cell resolution. So just so you can see, we get, you know, just from the few recordings we did, over 500 units, out of which 130 are single unit recordings in these measurements, and you can stick the electrode and record both from A1 and TEA simultaneously. To our surprise, when we mapped the FRAs of neurons in TEA, they were not significantly different from A1. So they get lots of inputs from A1, and they represent single tones in a similar manner, except for the high frequencies here, similar manner to the representations in A1. However, response latencies show this double peak, and always later than A1. A1 is sharp, this makes sense, it's upstream. And we get this very interesting late response, which we're just now starting to think of how to interpret them and record in an animal which is actually active and engaged in the task. So with this, I would like to thank the people who actually did the job. Most of the work I showed you is by Ido Maor, which has been with me for many years and is doing a great job. He built the EduCage and all the electrophysiological data. Ishai Eliada did the two photon imaging data. Gen and Libby are responsible for the last five slides where I showed off our new interest in temporal association cortex and the neuropixel recordings, and our long-standing collaborators, Ellie, of course, Lee Chan from Stanford, which I just mentioned, Chaim and Ravid, which has been a fruitful collaboration with the computational people, and Maya for the great viruses in the EVCF. These are our funders, and thank you for your attention.